Hey everyone, welcome to Sarah's Crossdressing Stories. Today I'm going to share with you Sister's Plan and My Beginning Part 39. If you're new to the channel, then please subscribe now for more captivating stories, and please support me on Patreon and get early access at patreon.com/sarah101. I awoke at my usual time. I was still sore, so I decided to take another bath. I felt relaxed and refreshed when I stepped out. I put on my undies and my face. I selected a conservative suit and white satin blouse for the trip, but I didn't put it on yet. Instead, I put on my jeans and work shirt. I went to the kitchen and prepared breakfast. I swallowed one of my vitamins with fresh OJ and had breakfast ready when Auntie came in. She looked at me and smiled. "Honey, I think that's a little informal for your trip," she said. "I thought that it would be nice to take Emily with me." We both giggled. "I don't think that they'll have a seatbelt big enough for her, do you?" As we ate breakfast, she told me to mind Mabel at all times and have a good time. We kissed as she left for work, and I said that I would see her tomorrow night. I left the dishes and hurried down to the stable. I let all the horses, except Emily, out into the corral. I moved Emily to an empty stall. Then I mucked out the stalls and put in fresh hay and water. I put Emily back in her stall and gave her an apple. I checked to make sure that the water trough in the corral was full and put out some fresh hay. Then I rushed back to the house and cleaned the kitchen. I was touching up my makeup when I heard the jet making its approach. I checked my overnight case and my hanging clothes bag to make sure that I had everything. I checked my appearance in the triple mirrors and was satisfied with my appearance. It was 8:15 according to my wristwatch, so I grabbed the bags and went outside after setting the alarm and locking the door. Grandma pulled in at 8:25 and I got into the car. We kissed, and after exchanging greetings, she said, "I'm pleased that you're ready. It's important to always be on time." We drove back to the runway and parked on the edge of the hangar ramp under a carport. A man in a uniform came to the car and took our cases. We walked to the plane and climbed aboard. The man got on board and pulled the combination steps and door closed and locked it. He went forward, and in a few seconds the plane started to move. From his seat in the cockpit, he advised us to buckle up for takeoff. Within minutes, we were airborne. I looked around the cabin of the Lockheed Jetstar. Designed in the early 50s for the military, the plane had later been adapted for commercial use. The configuration of Grandma's jet would seat 9 people, 5 on one side of the aisle and 4 on the other. Grandma leaned over to me and said, "You look very nice, my dear. An appropriate selection for our trip today." "Thank you." I wasn't sure if this would be right, so I have 2 other outfits with me plus my mauve party dress. "That suit is perfect. Today we are going to attend an executive board meeting at company headquarters. Tomorrow we will go on a tour of the logging and then the lumber production mills." The plane leveled off as we reached our altitude and the pilot came back. "Good morning, Mrs. Moore. How are you today?"
"Fine, Captain O'Toole, thank you.
How's the weather ahead?"
"It should be a gentle ride today.
No serious weather on our route."
"Oh, forgive me, I didn't introduce my granddaughter. This is Darla and Drake."
"Darla, and this is Captain Patrick O'Toole."
"Hello, Miss Drake."
"Hello.
I'm pleased to meet you, Captain. Perhaps Darla and could come forward later and see what you do up there," Grandma said. It would be our pleasure, Mississippi. Whenever you want to come, just shout.
Thank you, Captain. You're very kind.
If either of you ladies would care for coffee or tea, or a light snack, we have some available on the tray table for the last seat in the rear.
Would you like something now?
We both said no, and he said to just shout if there was anything we needed.
He returned to the cockpit at that point. Grandma told me more about her lumber operations, expanding on what she had taught me several days ago. She explained what would be discussed at the executive board meeting. She would sit at the conference table while I should sit in one of the chairs against the wall. If I paid close attention, I could learn a great deal about corporate America. I did pay close attention to everything she said. I knew that Grandma was incredibly knowledgeable from our past discussions, and I would listen to anything that she wanted to talk to me about. She explained lumber distribution procedures and problems in the U.S. and abroad. Then explained pricing and competitive bidding for contracts. She even went into futures trading. After about an hour, I asked Auntie if she would like some tea. I thought that she must be getting thirsty. When she said that she would, I got up and went to the rear of the small plane. I filled two cups from the thermos marked tea and put them on a tray with honey, cream, and some cookies that I found back there also. I returned and we prepared our tea, then Grandma resumed her instruction. Grandma told me that she was going to give me some facts to memorize, then opened her briefcase and pulled out a report. She quoted numbers about annual production in board feet of different types and grades of lumber and past, present and projected revenues in various markets. I committed them all to memory and then she asked me if I had them. When I said that I had, she questioned me in a random, mixed-order fashion and was pleased that I was able to answer all the questions correctly.
"Perfect, sweetheart," she said. "Remember that information, you'll need it later."
"Okay, Grandma." She then proceeded to instruct me in federal logging laws and replanting operations. By the time that we were told to put our seatbelts on for landing, I had amassed a considerable education about lumber operations. We were met at the airport by a limousine and driver. He took us to the company's headquarters building. We had lunch in the executive lunchroom and we met a number of executives there. Grandma introduced me as her granddaughter to all of them. They nodded hello, and then ignored me for the rest of the meal. After lunch, we went to the office of the company's executive vice president, Mr. Malone, and were escorted right in. Grandma introduced me and then got down to business as I sat passively at her side. She told her vice president that she was not happy with the performance of the company in the past quarter and she expected some changes to be made immediately. She laid out what she wanted done and a basic timetable. She told him that she would be passing the same information on to the executives in the upcoming meeting. She just wanted to give him a preview so that he would be better prepared to field some questions. He said that they would begin implementing the changes immediately. The three of us walked to the boardroom together. The other officers were already seated when we arrived. Grandma introduced me as her granddaughter and then pointed to where I should sit. She sat at the head of the table as president of the company. They went through the procedures of previous minutes, treasurer's report, old business, and new business. Under new business, Grandma opened a discussion of the subjects that she had conveyed to the executive vice president. She said that performance for the last quarter had slipped and she expected considerable improvement by next quarter. She called on a lesser vice president to answer a question about the number of board feet projected for the next quarter as opposed to the number produced for the same quarter during the past 2 years.
The person to whom she directed the question answered that he didn't have that data at hand. Grandma responded that those numbers should be indelibly burned into his mind. Darla and give Mr. Clemens the information. I rattled off the numbers and the dates. Mr. Clemens protested that those figures were meaningless because the grade of wood was not in demand anywhere. What grade is in demand, Mr. Clemens? He responded, and she asked him for the same numbers for that grade. He couldn't answer. Darla and, would you tell Mr. Clemens, please? I rattled off the correct numbers. So you see, Mr. Clemens, Grandma said, those figures are just as poor as the others. Mr. Clemens said that he believed I was in error about the numbers. One of the other executives spoke up and said that he had the quarterly report open and my numbers were absolutely correct for both grades. Mr. Clemens, Grandma said, in addition to an improvement in production, I also expect an improvement in you. I expect you to be able to give me vital information as easily as my 11-year-old granddaughter can. Are we clear? Yes, Mrs. Moore. Good. Now let's move on. I watched in amazement as Grandma ruled with an iron fist in a velvet glove. After a couple of hours, things started to wind down and Grandma started schmoozing all around. She thanked them for their support today and complimented their insightful remarks and contributions. She said that increased profits in the next quarter would mean increased bonuses at the end of the year. She had slapped them down a little, and now she was building them back up so that they left the meeting with a positive feeling. And she was reinforcing the fact that hard work would be rewarded. There was no doubt as to who ran the company, and by the end of the meeting, she had them eating out of the palm of her hand. Even Mr. Clemens, whom Grandma had slapped down hard for not knowing what he should, was smiling and joking after the meeting ended. Grandma was good, she was very good. After the executives had filed out to return to their duties and begin work on the new goals, Grandma came to me and hugged me. She told me how proud she was of me for producing those numbers for her when she needed them. She said that in future meetings, Mr. Clemens would know his business. I realized that that had been her intent all along. She ran the company as if she was playing a game of chess, and that was something I could relate to. She took me on a tour of the headquarters building, stopping to chat with, or chastise then schmooze, a number of individuals. In conversations throughout the building, she would call on me to produce facts when her managers could not recall them. As the end of the workday approached, we completed our tour and left the building. The limo was waiting to take us to an executive apartment that the company owned and kept available for visiting executives. Grandma showed me around and indicated which bedroom was mine. She said that we would leave for dinner in 2 hours, and I had time for a bath or a quick nap if I wanted. I opted for the bath since nothing relaxed me more. I soaked until I pruned, then got out and toweled off. I was spoiled and felt confined in the normal-sized tub. I dressed and put on my makeup and lipstick. I was wearing the mauve party dress that Grandma had bought me that first day at Xavier's. It was a little snugger in the hips than I remembered, but it looked lovely. I put on my shoes, took my purse, gloves, hat, and sweater, and went to the parlor. I was a little early and sat down to read a newspaper that was on the coffee table. It was called the Wall Street Journal, and I found it filled with interesting articles about companies, mergers, takeovers, new product development, bankruptcies, and a host of other business information articles. I hadn't known that such a newspaper existed before now. Grandma came in and saw me reading it and said, smiling, "Be careful that you don't overload your brain." That's deep stuff in there. I smiled and said, "This paper is wonderful. So full of useful information about companies. Udo, it looks like I've created a monster." A knowledgeable, very junior executive. But don't believe everything that you read in there. A lot of it is just copied from press releases. You have to learn to read between the lines. How do you learn to do that? Experience mostly. You have to be a faithful reader. Then after a while, you can separate the canned spiel from the real meat. How long do you think that will take? In your case, a few months. Some people read it for many years and can't do it. But you're different. You're amazingly perceptive for one so young. When I talk to you, I feel like I'm taking to a short, full-grown adult. I smiled. I'm growing up fast. I've learned so much from you. I'm grateful for your spending so much time educating me. And just watching you today was a pleasure, the way that you controlled the meeting and handled all those executives. First slapping them down for poor performance, then building them back up again and restoring their egos, so that when they left the meeting they felt like you were their best friend in the world. I was very impressed. There's that perception again. I'm glad you're on my side, sweetheart. Promise me that you'll never go to work for any of my competitors. Business is difficult enough with the people that they have now. I could never work against you, Grandma. She squeezed me, I know. I was just complimenting you in a joking way. Well, are you ready for dinner? Whenever you say the word. Dinner. I'm ready. We giggled and left after putting on our hats and grabbing our purses. We went outside and the doorman hailed a cab for us. Grandma named a restaurant and the driver put the cab in gear. She told me that we would be dining with several executives from a major lumber retailer and possibly some wives. We arrived at the named restaurant and went in. The maitre d' escorted us to the table where three men and two women sat sipping drinks. The men stood when they saw us approaching. Grandma shook hands with the oldest of the three men. It was obvious that they were old acquaintances. Grandma introduced me as her granddaughter, Darla, and then the older man, Mr. James Halley, introduced his party, which included his wife Julia, two business associates, Ray Demetrio, John Santos, and Mr. Santos's wife, Vera. We sat down and the waiter appeared. Grandma ordered a cocktail and asked me what I would like. I ordered a cola. The conversation started off with friendly chit-chat but eventually turned to business. The two wives became quickly bored and talked to each other about fashions and such, but I was fascinated with the business conversations and listened intently to all that was said. The men ignored the two wives and me, deciding that we were not privy to business matters. Halfway through our meal, Grandma turned to me and asked me for some of the numbers that I had memorized on the plane. That's all for now. See you in the next video. Please share your valuable opinion and please support me on Patreon to get the early access. Link in the first comment.